Well, thank you. It's wonderful to be here. It's wonderful to be here. I try to spend, as an art professor, try to spend a good deal of my time outside of the art department. I'm one of those, as probably most Torrey alumni, I'm one of those people who is interested in everything and occupy my own discipline as a kind of hub where all of the other disciplines run through it. Right. So it's good to be here outside of the art department a little bit, hanging out with my old gang, the Torrey gang. So good to see you all. I'm sick, so I feel like I'm in a metal tunnel, you know, a culvert pipe. So if I'm occasionally distracted or sort of drift off into incoherence, that's why. Sorry. So tonight I'm going to talk about The Tree of Life by Terrence Malick, which I confess is one of my favorite films. For sake of rhetorical flair, I'll just say it's my favorite film. How many of you have seen this film? Yeah, good. A good number of you. Good. All right. It's not an easy film, for those of you who have seen it, in the sense that I think it challenges a lot of conventions for making and watching films. It's just not a Hollywood film in a lot of ways. Upon first pass, the film feels very fragmented, even disoriented. It's very non-linear in all sorts of ways. There's relatively little dialogue in the film. In fact, I'm such a nerd about this film, I basically reconstructed the whole script just by like writing down the words, and that was not an enormous task. There's just not that much dialogue in the film. And the bits that we do get of dialogue are fairly fragmented, muffled very often, indecipherable. It's a strange film. Multiple narratives, as we'll talk about, are spliced together. Multiple frames of reference are sort of laid on top of one another. They interrupt one another. It has a challenging structure. In other words, it's a challenging film. But what I want to do tonight is read through it, read through the film, read it as though it were text. And I think we'll find that it actually has a relatively clear structure, actually. It's fairly simple, the structure of the film. The ways that it's structured in a fragmented way, even though it's a simple structure with a fragmented look, I guess we can say, I think it's very important, very intentional to what it means, what this film means. So we'll just read through it together. I'll read through it with you, read through this film. I suppose a warning, for those of you who haven't seen the film, this talk might be problematic in two ways. It might just be terribly confusing. Right? I'm gonna walk through the film, but because it is perhaps a bit confusing as a film, the way that I go through it might just be somewhat confusing. It might also be just a spoiler. That's actually the greater danger, I think. This might distract, if you haven't seen the film before, it might distract from the wonderfully disorienting experience of watching the film for the first time. That's really actually important to encountering this film as a text, to feel disoriented by it. So I might rob that sense of disorientation from you, and I hesitate to do that. Here we go. And that's fair warning. If you haven't seen the film and you really want to see it kind of for yourself, feel free to leave. I won't be offended or something. Okay. Let's dive in. And I want to begin tonight by showing you the first 3 minutes or so of the film. And we'll use that as a springboard into a discussion of it. So we'll just do this, and then we'll talk about it a bit. So this first 3 minutes or so of the film gives us several cues to the overall structure of the film that I want to pull on here, and we'll follow them through the rest of the film. First, this begins with an epigraph from Job, the book of Job. The film draws heavily on the book of Job. In fact, I think it shares its same basic structure. The overarching structure of the film is borrowed from the structure of Job, more or less, at least a good portion of it. And Malick makes the connection explicit in several places, beginning at the very beginning with the epigraph, and as well as in the very center of the film, halfway through, the most prolonged dialogue in the whole film is a sermon on the book of Job, a sermon from a priest. And that epigraph is Job, from Job 38, "Where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? When the morning stars sang together and all the sons of God shouted for joy." That provides an interpretive key to the rest of the film in a lot of ways. And like Job, this film features the questioning of God in the face of suffering. And the portion of Job that Malick chooses to head off the entire film, to lead out the entire film, is the point at which God finally speaks back and finally answers in the book of Job in chapter 38. And in some ways, we might interpret this film as Malick's attempt to articulate God's response. We might interpret it that way. The whole film tries to do that, and I'll elaborate on that a little later if I get to it. Secondly, there are some visual markers or devices that are used right here at the beginning, including that kind of nebula flame thing, right? Sort of whatever it is, a flame, a burning bush, a sort of stylized burning bush, I don't know. That is accompanied by the sounds of water, the sounds of waves. And those are important. This forms a kind of inclusio format, actually. It marks the beginning of the film. That same flame nebula thing will appear multiple times throughout the film, marking sort of chapter breaks or different parts of the film, different movements in the film. And we find that at the very end of the film, that sound will recur. In fact, water is one of the most powerful symbols in the film. There's this dialectic running through the whole film between desert and water. Desert and water. Being in a desert place, being in a water place. And it's a symbolic feature that hopefully we can unpack a bit later on. By the way, as we go through, as questions come to mind, I'll leave time at the end for some questions if you want to jot those down and be ready with them. And you also get there the relation between image and sound that Malick is going to do something very interesting with throughout the whole film, where you get an image that sometimes corresponds with the sound of what it is showing. Other times not. You'll get speech that is sort of disembodied voiceover, sometimes whispered, sometimes like at the very beginning, mother, brother. Sometimes it's a whisper, whatever that might be, a prayer perhaps. Sometimes it is some kind of a narration, as from the woman who's speaking. The nuns taught us there are two ways, the way of nature and the way of grace. And then, of course, music. And sometimes a muffling, what happens at the end there with the sort of rumbling of the airplane that goes mute as sorrow strikes Mr. O'Brien. Okay, so we get some of those things set up at the very beginning. A few other things happen in that clip that are important for us. It gets us into the story. Into the center of the story, which focuses on a family who lives in Texas in the 1950s, specifically 1956. And it's a family of five, and they are just known as Mr. O'Brien, no first name is given, Mr. O'Brien, Mrs. O'Brien, and they have three boys. The eldest is Jack, the middle is named R.L., and the youngest is Steve. And the story unfolds through the rest of the film in nonlinear fashion, through the interlacing of four different time periods. So throughout the film, there are four things going on, four different time frames that kind of wind together. First, there's the boys' childhood years as they're living in Texas in 1956, when the boys are 11 years old, 9 years old, and 6 years old, respectively. And that family has strong correspondence to Malick, like autobiographically. He was the oldest of three boys who grew up in Waco, Texas. Though he begins the script for the film, and occasionally throughout this talk, I'll be referring to the script. I managed to get a digital copy of the original script, which looks something like the film, sort of. And occasionally I'll refer to it as the script. I'm referring to Malick's, not the one that I kind of created from the film itself. So this corresponds to Malick's family, though at the very beginning of the script, Malick says, this is not my family, essentially. It's meant to be everyone's family, though it's pretty strongly his. So first time frame is this family, the boy's childhood. Second time frame is a day that we saw right at the end there, are perhaps fragments of a few days, about 10 years later, 1966 or so, in which Mr. O'Brien and Mrs. O'Brien learn that their middle son, R.L., has died. Some commentators assume that he's killed in the Vietnam War, though we don't get any further explanation than what you just saw, and there's not really any reason to think that it was Vietnam. It could have been. But it's not certain. Malick's middle brother also died, and so this is more of that somewhat autobiographic material. Malick's brother died in France, died of suicide, and this was something that Malick has very much wrestled with in his life, and so there's some kind of a correspondence here that he's wrestling through in this film. So first, the boys as 11, 9, and 6, then 10 years later when they find out that the middle son has died, and then thirdly, which we didn't get introduced to yet in the film, there's a day in the life of the oldest child, Jack, as an adult, and he's played by Sean Penn. This day is specifically the anniversary of R.L.'s death a few decades later. Kind of out of the section that we saw, this future day tumbles out of it, I suppose. And then the fourth time frame that the film takes up, for those of you who have seen it, it is the history of the cosmos. Okay. And these four histories, these four days, in a way, of microcosmic and macrocosmic scale, are just woven together throughout the whole film. And you chop back and forth between them as you move through the film. And that's one of the most disorienting parts of the film. What is going on? What is the narrative? I'll see if I can unravel it a little bit for you. Because of that fragmentary kind of effect, it's a little bit difficult to get one's bearings in the film. But once you do, I think it's fairly clear, fairly simple, that the film is, in fact, anchored in that anniversary day of RL's death. When the film takes place, I want to argue, is present day. On one day when the oldest of the boys is an adult, a fairly unhappy adult, looking back, trying to process his life, trying to process his grief and his guilt and his memories and his deepest beliefs in order to try to make sense of and reconcile himself to the death of his brother, as well as to reason with God, to struggle with God, to struggle to access once again the way of his mother, which we'll talk about here in a bit, and eventually to adopt a different posture toward life. So in other words, I'm arguing that this film, the entirety of the film, is actually the oldest adult brother's world, and his attempt to process his world and come to some kind of reconciliation with his life. And that kicks off, you get indication of that by that opening whisper. During that flame, there's a whisper. That is the oldest boy as an adult speaking, whispering, "Brother, mother, it was they who led me to your door." That's the opening phrase. And that's an evocative phrase because it's really slippery. The pronouns are slippery. Who's the they and who's the your? It first appears as though brother and mother are being addressed. Brother, mother, it was they who led me to your door. Well, who are the they? As the film goes on, we might wonder whether that is actually flips around the other way. Brother, mother, it was they, speaking of them in third person. Brother, mother, they were the ones that led me to your door. Who's the your? I think it's God. Perhaps. Brother and mother led me to your door. They were the guides back toward God. And I think that's what gets sorted out through the film, is trying to find the way of the brother and the way of the mother back toward God. And the pattern of the struggle that follows throughout the film is the pattern of Job, as I said, Book of Job. For those of you who have read Dante's Divine Comedy, there are some pretty strong cues that there might be some Divine Comedy going on. I mean, if this whole film is Jack thinking through his world, then that in some ways does map onto the Divine Comedy if we read it as an internalized processing of one's own hell, a descent into one's own hell, a grappling with one's own purgatory, and a witnessing of an ascent to one's own paradise in some ways. That if that's a kind of allegory for spiritual maturation, development, then that seems to go on in this film as well. In fact, there are, I won't go into it for sake of time, but there are guides that show up along the way, a sort of Virgil figure that is not very well identifiable. And in one portion of the film, the guide leads Jack up into this mouth, this huge stone head mouth that is a Renaissance sculpture that is called the Mouth of Hell. And you go up into the mouth of hell and into the blackness. And this is corresponds with Jack wrestling with his own hellishness. and we walk with him through purgatory in a lot of ways. But then once towards the end of the film, he has to be led by him, by his younger self. So the whatever guide was guiding him to that point has to stop, and someone else takes over, very similarly to the Divine Comedy. Okay, I'll leave that at that, but for those of you who are Dante nerds, you can you can see the film and see if you can make sense of that. Okay, those are some things that are set up from that first clip that we watched. The fourth thing that I think is set up in that first clip, and most obviously, perhaps, is that the prelude, what I'll call the prelude, provides the primary categories for understanding the main kind of pressures of the film, the interpretive pressures of the film. And they're provided by the voice of the mother, the brother and the mother that were spoken of. It's provided by the voiceover from the mother. And she says this: "The nuns taught us that there are two ways through life, the way of nature and the way of grace. You have to choose which one you'll follow." And then you get scenes of the mother's upbringing. And she's as you get those scenes, she's saying, "Grace doesn't try to please itself." And then you get this kind of paraphrase of 1 Corinthians 13, which is talking about love, but she names it as grace. It accepts being slighted, forgotten, disliked. It accepts insults and injuries. And you get, at that point, this field of sunflowers, which is an image that begins at the very, or appears at the very beginning of the film and appears at the very end of the film as well. And in Malick's script, he writes at the very end of the film, "Sunflowers, their heads turned toward their source, the unseen sun illuminating all with its bright shafts, pressing eagerly through the chinks and the cracks of the earth, driving darkness before it." The sunflowers for him are these little heads turned toward their source. And that's the way of grace. So grace doesn't try to please itself. And then the father appears in the film for the first time as the mother narrates, "Nature only wants to please itself, get others to please it too. It likes to lord it over them, to have its own way. It finds reasons to be unhappy while all the world is shining around it and love is smiling through all things." And it's important to notice that at the beginning of the film, we get the way of nature and the way of grace. But these are ways. They're not, Malick is not distinguishing between a realm of nature and a realm of grace. These are ways. There are two different ways of human life. And I think the best way to understand those is the way of nature is essentially the will to power. That's what it is. It's the way of trying to control beings, to control the world, exerting power over creation. That's the way of nature. The way of grace, on the other hand, is the way of love. It is a way of receiving being rather than trying to control it. And it manifests itself in, I think, as the film goes on, playfulness, gratitude, and self-sacrifice. Love of another. And in this way, the reason that I don't think we can read that as a distinction between the realms of nature and grace is that it's actually the way of grace that is actually attuned to nature and the world. It's the way of grace that receives creation attentively in an attuned way and with thankfulness. That's the way of grace. Whereas the way of nature actually ignores the natural world in order to control it, or is blunt to it, numb to it, I suppose. And then the mother's voiceover ends with, "They taught us that no one who loves the way of grace ever comes to a bad end." And as she's saying that, you're watching the middle son from behind, sort of turning towards the tree, and she's saying, "No one who ever loves the way of grace ever comes to a bad end. I will be true to you." Blackout is what happens with the image. "I will be true to you, black, whatever comes." Who's she speaking to here? I mean, she was telling us about the way of grace and the way of nature, and then she confesses that she'll be true to you, whatever comes. Is that spoken to grace? Is that spoken to God? Is it spoken to the middle son? I'll leave that an open question for now. And that moment then launches us into the central crisis of the film, which is the kind of irreconcilable event that plagues Jack's world, and that is the death of his brother, the death of the middle son. Okay, is that all right? Good? Yeah, well, any questions at this point of curiosity or comments about that opening scene and how it sends out threads or sends out rails through the rest of the film? Okay, I'll march on. Just as I'm transitioning, I'll give you a little bit of time. Okay. What I want to do at this point is then just kind of walk through the rest of the film and articulate what I take to be the kind of narrative structure of the film. And if you haven't seen this before, this may seem fairly simple. If you have seen it before, hopefully this is illuminating. The first part of the film, I think, is what I've been calling the prologue, where you set up the way of nature and the way of grace. And then it breaks into what I'm going to propose are five acts. In the actual script that Malick first wrote, the script that the film is presumably following, and it follows it more or less closely, he breaks it into three different parts. There's good reason for maintaining that, but I think I'm going to read it slightly differently than the author. That's okay. And identify five acts following the prologue for sake of kind of clarifying more of its movement. Because I'm not sure the three parts, they include lots of things in them. So the first act, I think, is posing the problem of suffering. And we saw the very beginning of that together. And the problem of suffering, and once again, if we begin with the prologue that's about nature and grace, the kind of dialectic between the way of nature and the way of grace, the problem, and those two will kind of run through all of these acts. They're what's at stake. Do I choose the way of nature or choose the way of grace? The problem of suffering, I think, is those who live by the way of grace do suffer and come to suffer and suffer perhaps more so than those who enter the way of nature. And the problem of suffering is that, in fact, the way of grace looks fairly weak in relation to the way of nature. And I think the film wants to set up that problem that in the face of suffering, great suffering, the way of grace appears weak, weaker than the way of nature. So why would you choose the way of nature is the problem, is the kind of question that the film opposes and asks. I'll just kind of talk through this this suffering. It has to do, it's first kind of identified with the mother and the father, loss of a child is an extraordinary suffering. And it was a suffering that riddled Malick's own family. And the mother articulates this suffering through these voiceovers once again. She says, "My son, he's in God's hands now." And this corresponds with this image of the spiraling stained glass going infinitely up, infinitely down. "He's in God's hands now. But he was in God's hands the whole time, wasn't he?" And thus, one of the primary questions of the film, what does it mean to be in God's hands? Is that a safe place to be? And then you get these scenes that map pretty closely onto Job. Some of Job's comforters come to aid her and comfort her, and they say sort of awful things. Like, the Lord gives and the Lord takes away. That's the way he is. He sends flies to wounds that he should heal. Thanks. And the father's grief is articulated, that his loss isn't just the loss of a son, but it is him coming to terms with how poorly he treated his children. "I didn't get a chance to say how sorry I was," he says in this scene. "I'm sorry for criticizing him for the ways that he did everything, turned the pages on the piano, at the piano, and so forth. I made him," he says, "I made him feel shame, my shame." Poor boy. That's how he ends that scene. And then we get a break. We get the emergence of another of those flame. The flame reappears. And we skip to the adult Jack. So we're going through this, and suddenly we are introduced to this person. And he is the oldest of the sons as an adult. He starts talking. "How did you come to me? In what disguise?" We are introduced to his life. He lives in buildings with lots of windows. They're very stark. They're very modernist. He works in a building that's very stark and very modernist. He seems to be fairly clearly clinically depressed. I mean, maybe we just get him on one day, but it seems like he is suffering from depression. This scene is interspersed. You get these really short shots of scenes of desert, something like this. And sometimes we're sweeping over that hill. Other times he's walking around in this desert. It is an interior space for him. He is a desert. He lives in a desert. He's in a desert state, I suppose we could say. And on this particular day, this blue candle recurs. It reappears multiple times. And the blue candle seems to be him commemorating his brother, his lost brother. And it recurs, once again, multiple times in the film. Almost everything appears multiple times. To do a really close reading of this film, you could just, like, tag almost every one of these short scenes see where else they come up. So this comes up again later in the film, this blue candle. And we see the adult Jack at work. He's a very powerful man. He seems to be some sort of an executive in an architectural firm or something like that. And he lives and works in this glass building and works very high up in the building, right? So he is riding elevator and so forth through much of the film, or through much of the times that we see him, or is looking out over the city. He's achieved some sort of position of power. Jack's world, the adult Jack's world, is extremely fragmented. his conversation, we almost never get an entire line from him, if you've seen the film. He is talking and we get just fragments of his speech. The camera is sort of all over the place. It won't stay put on him. The sound keeps dropping in and out. It's a very fragmented world that he lives in. And this portion is really opened up by the original script. Malick writes about this, so I'll just read some of it because it's quite illuminating to interpreting this section. He refers to this as the city of destruction, the artificial world. Jack wakes to find himself in that landscape of paralysis and despair, which today goes by the name of a city. What a sentence. The buildings hem round him like trees of a wild forest, a false nature, a universe of death, a sightless world roofed over, shut off from things above. Here one must stoop to walk, a world that would exclude the transcendent, that says, I am and there is nothing else, a world without love. We never see it whole, no skyline or defining monument, fragments only, a frenzy of things and people on the move, a continuous flow of trains and cars, a new babble. Change seems the only constant in this city, disappearance, loss, being is a shadow. There's nothing but this endless flux, nothing eternal, nothing sure, a new hell. Entirely of our times, a glass box. The sky is covered over, man has shut himself in. What is despair but to lose the eternal? this is his script for this scene. Okay. And so he is depicting the older Jack as powerful but lifeless in a way. He's someone who has followed the way of nature and achieved great power over nature and has sealed it in a glass box, so to speak. And he sort of pleads in the script anyway, someone to lead me out of the unreal to the real, lead me from darkness to light, lead me from death to eternal life. That's in the script. The way it comes out in the film is him asking, how did I lose you? How did I wandered, I forgot you. And I think that's the what poses to us the problem of suffering and the way of grace and the way of nature in the face of suffering. This, by the way, is a sort of haunting scene that just a fragment appears right at the end there. Act two, and I'll speed up through these, go through them relatively quickly. For sake of time, and then we can go back and talk about them in questions if you like. Act two, I think I'm going to refer to it as the problem of framing. If the first act really presses home the point of the problem of suffering, the way of nature, way of grace in the face of suffering, our second problem that the film presents to us is the problem of framing or of history, of framing an account of suffering. And in this, we get another light sort of nebula, one of those flames, and the mother returns in a voiceover, and she says, she pleads, she prays directly, Lord, why? Where were you? Did you know? Who are we to you? Answer me. And she's whispering these. And that whispering, or that answer me, seems to be taken very directly from Job's last words in Job 31, where he declares, I sign now my defense. Let the Almighty answer me. Let the accuser put his indictment in writing. And then Job's friends kind of go on and on. And then finally in Job, God answers in 38. And he answers with, where were you? Where were you when I set the foundations of the earth? And it's at this point in the film that we get the Big Bang. So if you've watched the film, we're like, you know, hanging out with this guy, and mother is asking, where were you? Answer me. And then suddenly we get this, and we get the a long, very beautiful, but long portion of the film devoted to the formation of the planets and of galaxies. This, by the way, is called the Eye of God, nebula. And we get fire and volcanoes, the formation of the earth, and so forth. And if you're watching the film for the first time, you're like, what is going on? What happened to this film? I was like, I was getting into it, and where am I? I'm in a nature film now. It's just Job 38 through 41. That's what is going on here. It is the answer. And it's a very disorienting answer, just as it is in Job. Answer me. I want an answer for my suffering. I'm an innocent man. I did nothing to offend you. I want an answer. And God's answer is, where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? You don't have any position from which to give an account of the world. You don't have any position from which to give a final accounting for suffering or for good and evil. You don't have that position. That seems to be God's answer in Job. And that is the answer that's, I think, given to us in this film, through this whole section. And the mother keeps pleading, we cry to you, my soul, my son, hear us. And we just get a further development of the earth, of the earth, and these map on to the days of creation. In fact, in the script, he just calls it creation. And we even get dinosaurs. which is odd as you're watching through the film, but if you're reading Job, it makes pretty clear sense. It's Leviathan. Do you train the Leviathan? And so Malick gives us Leviathan. And it is Leviathan wounded, dying. And as the film unfolds through this portion, you get the development of life, and it's just awesome, and it's beautiful. And I think we're supposed to take away from it that all of life is grace. I mean, all of being is grace. It's all of it is shot through with grace. And it seems to be deeply shaped by the way of nature. So you get this dialectic again, way of grace, way of nature that shapes history, that shapes creation itself. So what is it to choose the way of nature or the way of grace when you don't have a position from which to sort of see the big picture and offer a final accounting? That seems to be the problem of the framing. And we jump immediately from this creation narrative back to the birth of the children. We jump back to Texas and we get the birth of Jack. And as Malick says in his script, how does it happen that I am I and you are you, the slow, dark birth of the soul, greater and more mysterious than the birth of worlds? And so it's the miracle of life that gets celebrated. And the miracle of childhood. And this is one of the most beautiful parts of the film, in which Malick is just reveling in the way of grace saturating one's childhood, when all the world is wonderful and beautiful, and grace is smiling, love is smiling through all things. And it's a pretty compelling portion of the film. And the mother points into the sky at this point and says, "That's where God lives," which is an evocative phrase, maybe fitting for a young one, I don't know. And we get this development between the way of grace exemplified in the mother and the way of nature beginning to be exemplified in the Father. And I'll talk about that just a bit more later on. Act three, I'll try to hurry more quickly through these last couple acts. Act three, I think, is posing the problem of evil. And that's different than those previous two problems. The problem of evil, which we could call the way of nature. I mean, we could call it that in this act. And the problem here is that the way of grace appears to be weak in the face of the poison that's flowing through our veins. There's poison in us. There's some kind of a dark force in us and in our history and in the world. And the way of grace doesn't seem to be able to stand up against it. It seems weak in relation to it. This is the longest section of the film. And it's one in which Jack, he's the boy in the back, on the right there, it's in which Jack struggles increasingly with a darkness inside of him. Something's wrong with the world. In all sorts of ways. And this begins to occur to Jack and begins to shape him. And the kind of image of the way of nature in this portion of the film is his father. And his father says all sorts of things. Your mother's naive, way of grace. Your mother's naive. It takes fierce will to succeed. Don't let anyone tell you there's anything you can't do. Don't do what I did. I wanted to be a great musician. I let myself get sidetracked looking for something to happen, and that was it. I lived it, meaning he had children instead of becoming successful. And it seems like any time the father speaks, we get these kind of clips back to the desert. That's not entirely true, but you'll notice they come and go with the father. And the father teaches the boys to fight, and is very hard on them, and really embodies this will to power. And it is very strong in the script. It's even stronger than in the film itself. The father will go on these long kind of tirades in which he's lecturing Jack about how you need to belong to yourself. That's the whole thing in life. Learn to master yourself, your will. Your will is what makes you free. Set up your will as a law over you. I mean, it's like, okay, it's very strong. See those people, the people who are digging? Somebody got the upper hand with them. Don't let it happen to you. You've got to get ahead of the other guy. He'll be doing all he can to do the same to you. Money will break down all obstacles in your way. Hold on to it. It's the most reliable thing there is in this world. A friend is likely to betray you. Money never will. I mean, it's just much stronger in the script. But he is kind of indulging the way of power, the way of nature. And we see that the older Jack is really someone who has imbibed this deeply and has stepped into it, becoming what his father wished he could have been. And during this portion, the father leaves on vacation, and so you, or not vacation, on business, and so you just have the mother, the way of grace, with these children, and the children run wild. And Jack becomes increasingly violent and cruel, throwing rocks through windows, destroying flower beds. They set off a frog on a bottle rocket. And in the script, it has this wonderful, heartbreaking line where it says, and they went to go find the frog, and it was gone. And they had felt its life pulse in their hands, and they destroyed it. And that's that kind of cruelty that sets in during this portion of the film. And in the script anyway, this has really strong allusions to Genesis 3. In particular, there's this scene where he sneaks into the neighbor's house and goes up into the bedroom and takes one of the slips, nightgowns of the woman. And then next thing we see him doing is running to the river and burying the nightgown. It's some kind of a violation of boundaries in all sorts of ways. And the script is really strong in its allusions to Genesis 3. He goes, he hides this nightgown, he buries it. His eyes dart left and right. No normal boy would do this. Of that, he's sure. He should have stayed out of the house, but he chose not to. And now he knows the tree of knowledge. And it goes on. Nature, which once sang around him, is silent now. And yet he feels a subtle alteration in himself, a freedom with new powers of reason and understanding. So this is how they see the world. With the opening of his eyes, new hopes awaken, the promise of new joys, their taste so sweet in his anticipation of them that all he has known before seems stale and flat. His mother begins to walk through the yard in the cool of the evening, repeating the question, "Where are you?" I mean, it's like overtly Genesis 3. He feels conscious of himself, inwardly naked. He trudges heavily back toward his home. It does not seem the place he knew before. He hears something like breath or footsteps of someone coming after him, the voice of a stranger far away. What ship has carried him off? To what far land? He'll never be a child again, right? You get this kind of Genesis rupture narrative in here, where you have the introduction of shame and of rupture with the mom, the way of grace. And then following that, you get this kind of Cain and Abel thing, as you might expect if he's following Genesis, a Cain and Abel thing going between between Jack and his younger brother, R.L. And that includes, in the script, it's actually overtly Cain and Abel. They both give gifts to their mother. He gives a paperweight, and the brother gives a watercolor painting, and he could tell he spent money on the paperweight, and his brother just made a painting for free, and he can tell that his mother loves the painting more. It's Cain and Abel. And then you get this sort of series of scenes in which the brother, Jack, is testing his younger brother, testing his trust, and that culminates in him asking him to put his finger over the gun, the BB gun, if you've seen this, and he fires, shoots his brother's finger. And I think we're supposed to take that as a kind of Cain-like transgression of the innocent Abel. Okay, there's much more to say. Oh, this is the kind of testing. Stick a hanger in a light socket, and of course he doesn't shock him at that point. It's only later that he does the BB gun thing. Okay, just two more acts quickly, and then we'll make some time for questions. Act four, I think, is where we get repentance. It's where we get repentance in Jack, where he is whispering in ways that call up Romans 7. What I want to do, I can't do. I do what I hate, right? And it sounds very much like Romans 7. And he begins praying. What was it you showed me? I didn't know how to name you then, but I see it was you. Always you were calling me. After he apologizes to his brother and is forgiven. We also get a turn in the father. He loses his job, and he kind of confesses that he wanted to be loved because he was a great man, a big man, and now I'm nothing. There's glory around us, trees, birds, and I lived in shame. I dishonored it all and didn't notice the glory. I'm a foolish man. Right? This is the sort of turn in the film. And it's at this moment that Jack, I think, sees the way of nature as destroying him and destroying others. It's an exercise of power that leaves one empty and in some ways takes its toll, a heavy toll on him. And we could sort our way through this. It includes the young Jack, I think, repenting. It also includes the old Jack, and we get him now wandering through the desert. And this is, once again, interior. All of this, I think, is the older Jack trying to work through his life. And so we get all of these impressionistic images that sometimes are depictions of memory, sometimes they're depictions of emotional states, sometimes they're depictions of hopes or beliefs or fantasies or whatever. Lastly, we get redemption? No, maybe. And this is the part of the film that I have the most trouble with. it gets kind of wild, kind of splashy, sort of sentimental. In some ways, we get a new creation, and that Malick indicates that in the script, that this is supposed to be a new creation. So we get new creation scenes. But you also seem to get resurrection. There's some kind of an eschatology going on. There's scenes of someone reaching down into a grave and a hand starts reaching up. And you have all of these people who are gathering on the shore and by the ocean, including the adult Jack. And so he has traveled from desert to ocean. And Malick refers to this as the ocean of eternity, is where they're going to. And it is a reunion that occurs, and it is also some kind of a release on the part of the adult Jack, a falling to his knees in the water at the ocean. There's a reunion between the members of the family that once again are seen as young people, but then the adult Jack is also walking around in here. So there's some kind of a time disjuncture there that I think just alludes to the fact that you have the adult Jack who's processing through all of this stuff, and he's remembering and imagining his childhood and seeking some kind of a reconciliation of that childhood. And there also appears this letting go of the son, the brother, rather, letting go of the brother across these salt flats and letting go of the mother across the salt flats into eternity, I suppose, letting go of them. And then you end with the sunflowers once again. They're not quite the very end, but they're right there at the end. And I want to read, just to wrap up, I want to read a little bit more from the script because I think it's illuminating to what is going on in the images at the back, at the end of the film. After the sunflowers, we go back to adult Jack. That's the thing. Like what I struggled with this film was what's going on at the end. It's like Kingdom of Heaven or something, resurrection, but it's very sort of over the top, sentimental, sort of strange, sort of not quite fully physical. Like it was just not Christian enough. But I don't think that's just what it is. I don't think it's just the resurrection. It is a giving over, Jack giving something over, Jack coming to peace with the death of his brother, and I think with the misguidedness of his life, the following the way of nature. And what we get at the very end is not the eschaton, but you get Jack again, as an adult, exiting the glass building, walking past a tree that is being transplanted. And here's how the script narrates that portion. We are back with Jack in the city. Even in these streets, the eternal shines. This is God's world and not an infinite plane of chaos and sorrow after all. Though he must linger here a while, yet he will not despair. A new life lies before him, a faith which sees through death. We return to the present, to the noise and confusion of the everyday, to the place where we set out from. We see it now as though for the first time. What seemed plain and familiar glows with a radiance it did not display before. We found the infinite in the everyday, in the commonplace. And going on, eternity, that realm of pure and endless light, how shall we represent it? I wonder if he's talking to himself here. Like, I mean, as a filmmaker, how shall we represent it? A ladder leading up into a tree, sparks flying up from a fire, a bridge, a kiss, a solitary island. A single image might serve better than several combined. In fact, the whole creation in the figure of a tree. The smallest leaf communicates with the lowest root, all parts feeding on the same sap, breathing in the same air and sunlight, drawing the same life up from the darkness of the earth below. Simple images captured with a pinhole camera. After the nervous movements of time, we see that of which time is a moving picture, the image of the tree of life. And with that, we get the return of the flame and the sound of birds and a shore, just like at the same at the beginning of Breaking Water. We get the image of a bridge in San Francisco, a bridge, which is one of those images he referred to as the image of eternity. And then it cuts sharply to black, just as it opened. Okay. That's talking through the film. I'll stop there. And if you have any questions, maybe we could sort out some of those together. Okay. Well, yeah. Thanks. And it's about 8:45, so if you need to go, go. But if you have questions or comments about the film, I'm happy to chat a bit about it and maybe field a couple of questions. So if you have to go, don't feel bad about that. But if you have questions, I'll take a few. Yeah? Questions? Yeah.
The three parts
that he breaks it up into. So Malick divides, basically the first part runs through the creation of the world. So it goes all the way from the beginning through the creation. Part two then goes from the birth of Jack and the childhood all the way through, I think it goes all the way through the those scenes of eternity at the end. And then part three is very short. Yeah, it's very short. It's basically Jack, returning to the adult Jack, and Jack trying to resolve to change his life. Yeah. So that's helpful, but sort of, I don't quite understand why the breaks are there. So I did something different. And that's the way he makes his films. If you know anything about his films, he starts with a script, but he rarely uses the script in the shooting of the film. He just lets people go, lets people, here's the scene we're trying to do, and he just rolls film and lets people interact with each other. In fact, the children weren't given the script to read at all. And the adult actors were given the script to read and then given typed notes at the beginning of each day that they talked about, and then that he had typed that morning, and then they just ditched them and sort of improvised. It's very improvisational. So I think I have some justification to change, to reread what the film is actually doing, because he changes it as he builds the film. Yeah. Good. Yeah.
How much do you know about Terrence Malick himself? Is he very open about
his belief? Yeah. So a bit about Terrence Malick himself. I wondered whether I should start with that, and I decided not to, just for to avoid a whole lot of throat clearing. But Terrence Malick as a person is fascinating. He is a philosopher by training, so he was trained in philosophy at Harvard under Stanley Cavell, which is significant, and then went to Oxford as a Rhodes Scholar to do his PhD, and wanted to do his PhD on Martin Heidegger, if any of you know Heidegger. He's a phenomenologist, one of the great contributors to phenomenology, which phenomenology is where you, it's essentially trying to do philosophy. The starting point of phenomenological philosophy is to attend to the way the world presents itself, the phenomena, attend to the phenomena. For Heidegger, one begins philosophy not by trying to identify foundational principles that you can start your reasoning from or something like that, or to get to the essence of things. It is to start from the experience of being in the world. That's a really short explanation of Heidegger. There's a lot more to it. But arguably, Malick's films are deeply Heideggerian, and I think he would say that as well. They are phenomenology, which is one of the reasons he ditches his script, that he doesn't want to represent something. He wants to kind of build a script, build a trajectory, but also let the camera witness something happening for the first time, rather than something that's rehearsed or whatever. That's one part of it. Another part of Heidegger, Malick being Heideggerian, is that for Heidegger, world, the idea of one's world is very important. How does a world show up as a world? Like that, and world, not just that this stuff is here, but that it's intelligible, there's some kind of intelligible ligaments that hold one's world together, that includes memories, that includes language, that includes all sorts of things. And in a lot of ways, this film and all of his films explore world, the notion of world. This is Jack's world in the deep Heideggerian sense, how one makes sense of the world and negotiates the world. Okay, so that's a little bit about Malick. Though he left, his supervisor at Oxford didn't want him to work on Heidegger, because Heidegger wasn't respected at Oxford at the time, in the 50s, or 60s, I think he was there in the 60s. So he abandoned his PhD midway through and decided filmmaking is the place I need to do philosophy. It's the most appropriate place, I suppose. So that's a bit about Malick. Religiously, he's Episcopalian. I think his films, particularly this one, is like overtly Christian in a lot of ways. I mean, you know, you can't be talking about the way of nature and the way of grace without like calling to Aquinas, right, or what have you, and the references throughout this film are pretty deeply biblical. I mean, he's calling up, particularly as I was showing in the script, he's calling up Genesis, Job. In one portion in the script, he refers almost directly to Augustine when Jack is running off the rails. He has in the script, he goes and he steals some peaches, he and some friends, they steal some peaches, and then it says that they threw them away. They stole them not to eat them, but just to throw them away, which is Augustine's Confessions, right? I mean, directly, I think it's peaches in Augustine, right? Is it? Pears, it's pears. It gets changed to peaches, you know. He's really modifying it a lot. Is that helpful, a little background about Malick as a person? Yeah. He's very, if you know anything about him personally, which I don't know a whole lot, he's very reclusive. He hates media. He hates Hollywood. Hates media attention. And so avoids it at sort of all costs. He's just not interested in that. And you kind of get that from his films. He's making films for a totally different reason than entertainment. I mean, he's making films as theological texts, as philosophical texts, and they reward contemplative viewing, I think. Anyway, yeah, in the back. By him? Yeah. Days of Heaven is really wonderful. His first film, he hasn't made very many. He takes years to make a film. Days of Heaven is a very beautiful film. Badlands, I think, is his first one. Which is it's a young Malick, but it's already Malick. You can already see much of what he's doing. He also did The New World, I believe it's called, which is about kind of colonialists coming to the New World. And the sort of tensions of those two worlds in a Heideggerian sense, colliding, indigenous and kind of European worlds colliding. And I think trying to think through love and power in the midst of those collisions. That's a really interesting film. He's also well known for The Thin Red Line, which is, it's a war film. It's profound and it's very beautiful, but it's a war film, so you got to be ready for that aspect of it. More recently, he's just been cranking out films, astonishingly. So he did this in 2011, Tree of Life, that was followed very quickly by a film called To the Wonder, which is a good film. It's, I feel like it's sort of the B-sides of Tree of Life. It's a beautiful film, it's very good, and it's about also taking up some autobiographical story of a troubled marriage, a failing marriage, working through questions of the way of grace in the midst of a failed marriage. And then most recently, which I haven't seen yet, is the film The Knight of Cups, which I've heard is just brilliant, and I've been reading as many reviews as I can get my hands on, but I haven't seen it yet. From what I understand, it very much takes the motif of the desert and the ocean that is going on in Tree of Life and makes that like a central movement from day to morning, or I'm sorry, from night to morning, from desert to ocean. And that's the kind of, it's trying to construct images of redemption, of retrieval, self-retrieval. All right, I think that actually might be all of his films that I just named. Other than, he has some that he's produced, but I think those are all the ones that he's made. I think, are there any others? I don't know about, I think those are all of them. A few more. Oh. Yeah, that's right. So he's written. Yeah, that's right. That's right. So he's written several more and produced several more. I think those are the ones I named are the ones that are like that he produced, directed, and wrote. I think he did all of it. So check out IMDb. And see what the other ones are on there. I don't remember off the top of my head. Yeah, was there another hand, Joe?
I was wondering if the part where he's enclosed in glass and just in the modern city and the script made that so much clearer than the
yeah.
movie. And I was wondering maybe if he might even think it's kind of an artistic flaw that maybe he's so good at making
yeah, yeah. In the other ones. Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's possible. I think that portion with Sean Penn as the adult Jack. Yeah, it's beautiful. It's beautiful and cold and geometric and fragmented and muffled. I mean, I feel uncomfortable about those scenes. And I guess knowing how interested he is in Heidegger, I guess I see them pretty quickly as. I mean, Heidegger had some really strong things to say about technology and the evils of technology, the way that it frames the world, as Heidegger would say. So I think I see that pretty strongly in the film itself. And I think as I was referencing the script and reading the script's account of that, it seemed to name even more strongly than I would have named it just from watching the film. That I read it out loud because it really makes the point. But I think it's there. I mean, maybe beautiful. He just is. They're beautiful films. Anything he does, even the dark aspects are very beautiful. But I think still difficult. He does difficulty pretty well, I think. And that portion where Jack is kind of tumbling into his own shame and his own the young Jack into his own way of nature. I mean, I think that's a pretty powerfully dark part of the film. In fact, one of my problems with the end of it is that it doesn't seem to have as much meat on its bones as the parts that are kind of darker and more disturbing, you know? So I don't know, whatever that's worth. Yeah, good. Any other? Well, we'll go here and then I'll go back there. Devin, hi. Yeah. Yeah. That the question is is the theology of this film emotional, overly emotional, or ethereal? Was that the other word you used? Yeah. Yeah. Good. I think it is deeply emotional theology, in the. Best sense of the term. I mean, it is, so if he's influenced by Heidegger, he's also influenced by Kierkegaard. I mean, I think this is a sort of Kierkegaardian religion in some ways, or theology in some ways, that one has to confront God personally, like as a person, and has to wrestle with God and wrestle with the darkness and wrestle with the light and live in the way of grace or the way of nature with everything as personally at stake as possible. And that includes the emotions, maybe especially in some ways. And I suppose it's also one of the people who's written, I think, most eloquently about this film is the theologian Peter Lighthart, who's great. He wrote this great book called Shining Glory, and it's a thin little guy. Right there, isn't that nice? Theological Reflections on Terrence Malick's Tree of Life. And Lighthart, toward the end of the book, argues that the film seems to be making the argument that there is no argument, ultimately, a rational argument for the way of grace. There's a rational argument, but the most powerful one is the experience of grace and the experience against that, the experience of the way of nature. And there's a kind of a way that one has to be in to understand. So in that sense, it's very experiential, very emotional theology. But perhaps that's a virtue, at least I'm arguing it as a virtue. As for the ethereal part, he is sometimes accused of being Gnostic. I don't think he's Gnostic, but he gets accused of that sometimes, as there's the eternal and there's the material, and they're kind of, you have to sort of detach from the physical for the eternal or something like that. I don't think that explains the film very well, but.
Biola University prepares Christians to think biblically about everything, from science to business to education and the arts. Learn more at biola.edu.